Good morning, church family. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the streaming service of First Baptist Church, North Kansas City this morning. We're going to go ahead and get started with our worship by singing, I Go to the Rock.
Where do I go when there's no one else to turn to? Who do I talk to when no one wants to listen? Who do I lean on when there's no foundation stable? I go to the rock, I know the table. I go to the rock.
Deuteronomy chapter 8 today, if you'd like to join. As I read, if you're willing and able, I ask that you stand in reverence for the reading of God's word. All the commandments that I am commanding you today, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord swore to give to your forefathers. You shall remember all the way which the Lord your God has led you in the wilderness these 40 years, that he might humble you, testing you to know what is in your heart, whether you would keep his commands or not. He humbled you and let you be hungry, and fed you with manna which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you understand that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by everything that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, nor did your foot swell these 40 years. Thus you are to know in your heart that the Lord your God was disciplining you, just as a man disciplines his son. Therefore you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God, to walk in his ways and to fear him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, fountains and springs, flowing forth in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive oil and honey, a land where you will eat food without scarcity, in which you will not lack anything, a land whose stones are iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper. When you have eaten and are satisfied, you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land which he has given you. Beware, you do not forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments and his ordinances and his statutes, which I am commanding you today. Otherwise, when you have eaten and are satisfied and have built good houses and lived in them, and when your herds and your flocks multiply and your silver and gold multiply and all that you have multiplies, then your heart will become proud and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. He led you through the great and terrible wilderness with its fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty ground where there was no water. He brought water for you out of the rock of flint. In the wilderness, he fed you manna, which your fathers did not know, that he might humble you, and that he might test you to do good for you in the end. Otherwise, you may say in your heart, my power and the strength of my hand has made me this wealth. But you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who is giving you power to make wealth, that he may confirm his covenant, which he swore to your fathers as it is this day. It shall come about, if you ever forget the Lord your God, and go after other gods and serve them and worship them, I testify against you today that you will surely perish. But the nations that the Lord makes to perish before you, so you shall perish, because you would not listen to the voice of the Lord your God.
And what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the
Good morning, church. I want to welcome you this morning and thank you for joining us today on social media, on our live streams. You've made it this far, so we ask that you go ahead and like and share this video as a way of us just kind of continuing our work of evangelism in our community, but also making sure that our streams are great and everyone's participating. And so since I can't ask anybody to turn to the neighbor next to you and shake hands, go ahead and chat hello in the chat box and say hello to the person digitally sitting next to you, I guess. And since so many things are digital, at least for the time being, the good news is we are trending back to normal. But until then, a lot of our regular things that are still moving are possible. And so you can give online, for instance, your tithe or offering. I would like to make a quick note, though. Next Sunday, we will be having our Lord's Supper. And so make sure you come prepared to next Sunday morning service. And if you need the individual little packets, they can be provided by the church office. So just contact us and let us know if you need that. Also, we're looking forward to Pastor Jim starting with us next month. And yep, those are all of my announcements. Thank you.
More than enough for all of me.
every thirst and every need. You satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than
Good morning. I am going to be sharing with you our focus passage for today from the book of Luke, chapter 9, verses 10 through 17. When the apostles returned, they reported to Jesus what they had done. Then he took them with him, and they withdrew by themselves to a town called Bethsaida. But the crowds learned about it and followed him. He welcomed them and spoke to them about the kingdom of God and healed those who needed healing. Late in the afternoon, the 12 came to him and said, "Send the crowd away so they can go to the surrounding villages and countryside and find food and lodging, because we are in a remote place here." He replied, "You give them something to eat." They answered, "We only have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, unless we go and buy food for all this crowd." About 5,000 men were there. But he said to them, disciples did so, and everyone sat down. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke them. Then he gave them to the disciples to distribute to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. Would you pray with me? Father God, we come to worship longing to encounter you. Yet often our attention is scattered and our minds are on other things. Sometimes we are fully attending, but not to your presence. Rather, our minds and hearts are occupied with other gods, the cultural gods of society. Father, call us to account. Give us the strength of will to resist. Turn us to you and away from the gods of society. Help us to continue in worship of you in spirit and in truth. Father God, I praise you and thank you that you are more than enough. Those words, more than enough than I want or need. Thank you, Father. God, I pray as that as Pastor Mike comes and shares this morning message, that you would do just that, God. Help us to focus our minds and our hearts, that we may hear from you without distraction, that we be fully present, God, in your presence. In your name I pray, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. So glad to have you on Facebook live stream with us today and watching and fellowshipping with you this morning. It is very, very good. I have a white stone invitation for you today, a white rock invitation. In the ancient world, if someone gave you a white stone, it could have had several meanings. One of the meanings would have been, you're invited. You are invited to the banquet, you're invited to the party. It's a special invitation, and you would use the white stone to enter. Another meaning in the ancient world is that if you had been charged with some wrong, some crime, and then you were found to be not guilty, acquitted, then you would be given a white stone, and you could have that white stone as evidence, a symbol, a sign that you had been acquitted. You're not guilty. The white stone also could be just an expression of friendship, commonality, mutuality. And so there are several meanings to the white stone. I want to extend a white stone invitation to you today with all of those associated meanings. That you're invited to a banquet with Jesus. You're invited to be found not guilty by his righteousness. And you're invited to be what he calls one of his friends, You're invited into a friendship fellowship with Jesus Christ and into the friendship fellowship of all believers and all of us here at First Baptist Church, North Kansas City. So I extend to you today a white stone invitation. I want to invite you also to a scene that might be around at your house on pizza night, or a scene around your house on it's tacos tonight. Good stuff for sure. And the family gathers in, and there's no trouble getting the kids to come when it's their favorite meal being served. And yet mom and dad wisely are there. Not too much of that, a little more of this. You can have a few more bites of the meat for the protein and to build your muscles. You can have a few more bites of the carrots and the broccoli because they have vitamins that you need. And so a little bit more of this, a little bit less of that, but it is taco night, hamburgers off the grill night, good stuff. I want to invite you then also to a scene that's similar. Mine was in a critical care unit. For a number of years as a registered respiratory therapist, one of my roles was to be on the nutrition support team. Nutrition really is a respiratory therapy function. Just cutting to the chase, our aerobic metabolism consumes oxygen and produces carbon dioxide, and our lungs regulate our oxygen levels and our CO2 levels. And so in a real way, nutrition is a respiratory therapy function, and I'm in the critical care unit as a part of a nutrition support team, and we're making rounds to look for the most critically ill patients who might need a little more nutritional support, who might need a little more calories, a little more protein, and yes, even a little more fat in their diet, because fat helps us regulate oxygen levels, believe it or not. And so this was the scene that I want to create, whether it's at the kitchen table at home and mom and dad are saying a little more of this and a little less of that, or it's a nutrition support team making rounds in an ICU at the hospital. A little more of this and a little less of that. We are not fully fed until we are fed with all of the things that are good for us. We are not fully fed as believers until we are fully fed, yes, physically. The nutrition support that we need for strong bodies and strong minds, yes. But we are not fully fed until we're spiritually fed. And in the passage today, our Luke chapter 9, verses 10 through 17 passage, it is about being fully fed. It is on the one hand being fully fed physically, but oh, so much more to be fully fed spiritually. I hope that you'll turn to Luke chapter 9, verses 10 through 17. We will be in those verses and we'll look at a few others as well. We're going to look at being fully fed. We are in our Ministry in the Margins series, going through selected verses in the book of Luke. Ministry in the Margins, Fully Fed is our sermon message title today. Let us turn and look at that passage together. In Luke chapter 9, verse 10, I need to set up with you that it says, when the apostles returned, they reported to Jesus what they had done. What they had done is what is written about in Luke chapter 9, 1 through 6. And in it, there's a couple of recurring themes. Jesus had sent the disciples out sort of as an exercise training, a clinical experience, if you will, for them, an internship for the disciples. They had been with Jesus. They had seen him do exactly what he was sending them out to do. This is one of the ways we disciple one another. This is one of the ways we equip one another to do the work and the ministry of the church, to do the mission of the church that God has called us to do. And so he has sent the 12 out, and he says, drive. He's given them the authority to do these things. It's not in their power, but in God's power. Drive out all demons, cure diseases. and he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. And then in verse 6 again, they had done that, and they had gone from village to village proclaiming the good news and healing people everywhere. So it's that experience, that field experience, that they are now back with Jesus for a debriefing. And I am reminded of being on mission trips myself, evangelism trips of going out and just seeing God at work, his power, his authority at work through his people that make themselves available, who surrender themselves to his call on their lives. And just to see God open doors and work in people's lives and transform lives. Wow. It's like going to youth camp and coming back, and we all have those mountain high experiences, and we want to come back home and tell other people about it. And we want to apply some of those lessons learned from the retreat or the youth trip or the mission trip. We want to come back and apply some of those. And so they're here, and they're wanting to tell Jesus. They're wanting to debrief with him, is what it says in chapter 9, verse 10. They wanted to share all that they had done, and so he took them, and they withdrew by themselves to a town called Bethsaida, and away from the crowds, verse 11. Now, the crowds have been following, and we'll talk about those crowds and how Jesus responded to the crowds. But at this particular moment, he's like, yeah, guys, let's go debrief. Let's go retreat. Let's go hear the stories, apply the lessons learned, figure out what we did well and what we can do better the next time we go out. The next time I send you out. And there's going to be a next time. It's in the next chapter. It's in Luke chapter 10 when he sends 70 out in pairs with the same assignment. That's how discipleship works. To be fully fed as a disciple, as a follower of Jesus Christ, means to observe what he has shown us to do and then try to repeat that, reproduce that. And so he had sent them out on that field experience. In a way, he had sent them out to be mom and dad around the kitchen table. He had sent them out as the nutrition support team in the critical care unit. Take the good news that the God, their Father, sent the Son. Take the good news that the Son is here. He is your Messiah. Take the good news the Messiah is going to the cross. He's going to pay for all sin debt. Take the good news. And as you go, meet needs and show love and reflect Christ and be that, be Christ to those as you go. So to be fully fed means that we take in all of Jesus and take in more, bigger portions, even more portions, second servings. I'll have some more, please. More, please. Well, the crowd, the retreat with the guys, the 12 disciples and Jesus, it didn't last very long, because in verse 11, the crowds learned about it and followed him. To be fully fed means to meet people with hospitality. So the incessant interruptions, the no, not one more need, not another text message, not another email, not another crisis on the other end of the phone line, no. To be fully fed, Jesus said we have to be hospitable. We have to meet people where they are. Let's look at what Jesus did with this crowd that's kind of imposing on the private party with the disciples debriefing. In verse 11, he welcomed them. He spoke with them. And he healed them. In verse 13, he gives them something to eat. In verse 14, he has them sit down. Sit down, stay, I'm going to feed you. We learn that in Mark and in the Gospel of John about this same story, this same experience of feeding the 5,000, that this was a grassy area. It was in a remote place. It was isolated, but it was a grassy area. And he had them sit down, get comfortable in the grass. He was being hospitable. In verse 16, he gave the bread and the fish to the disciples to then go distribute to the 5,000. He was being hospitable. To be fully fed, we have to be fully hospitable. To be fully fed, we have to be fully giving back what Christ has shown us to do. To be fully fed, we have to be fed by Christ to give back what Christ gives us. To be fully fed, we have to give back in the way that he gave. And he was hospitable. Even in the midst of, it's not convenient right now. Do you know what time it is? Don't you see that I'm with my guys and we're in a private session? It isn't terribly convenient to be one who fully feeds others, who takes an active role with Jesus in feeding others. But we see that that's what Jesus models here. And as he is modeling it, he is involving the disciples in this discipleship lesson for them. He's saying, you're going to have a part in this, my disciples. You're going to have an active role in this. It's not about just what I can provide. And by the way, I can provide it without you, but I want you. Oh, I want you to be a part of it, to be blessed by being a part of it, to be fully fed by being a part of it, take in a feeding by doing, take in a feeding by following. To be fully fed with all the right stuff means to be fully fed with the Word of God. In verse 11, he spoke to them about the kingdom of God, to the crowd. He spoke to them about the kingdom of God. He was teaching the word that we have today in Scripture. It is exactly what he had sent the disciples out to do in chapter 9, verses 1 through 6, to go proclaim the kingdom of God. And so, to be fully fed means that we take in his word and we take it in more and we take it in bigger doses and we take it in more frequently. Many, many meals of his word. Here's the danger. Some of us can just snack on the word. Oh, my Bible verse of the day popped up on my phone. I am good. Oh, so-and-so posted a scripture passage on Facebook today. I am good. No, you're snacking at best. To be fully fed means you are in the Word of God. You're digging deeper in the Word. So to be fully fed means to be in the Word. He spent so much time that day, the majority of the time that day was spent in the Word, his Word. They had started in the morning, and then in verse 12, it is late in the afternoon. So from morning until late in the afternoon, Jesus has been teaching the word, the word, the word, the word, the word, his word. Jesus knew something about becoming hungry. As the day had worn on, the disciples were rightly concerned about the crowd, wondering how they would be fed and who would do it. And I'm reminded in Matthew chapter 4 when the tempter, the evil one, had Jesus in the wilderness and he had been fasting for 40 days and for 40 nights. And Satan said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. And Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes out of the mouth of God. There is a physical life that comes from physical bread. But to be fully fed, oh, to have the best feeding, means we live on every word that comes out of the mouth of God. Really. The scripture really couldn't be more clear. Yes, you can feed people physical meals, and Jesus wants us to feed people physical meals. But the priority, the prize, the package excellence, the message is to feed people spiritually. Physical feeding without spiritual feeding will mean I die. That's the way it works. This physical body, no matter how well I provide nutrition to it, will only last so long and do so much. I'm not fully fed, and we're not fully feeding others until our priority is feeding them the Word of God. To be fully fed means we look at the disproportionate dimensions of things and see how God can be at work. So in the midst of enormous need and limited resources and extreme conditions, Jesus shows the disciples and Jesus shows the crowd how to be fully fed. Oh, in verse 14, there are 5,000 men, and if you study this, you understand that it probably means they weren't counting the women and children, and so that there are, in all likelihood, a much bigger crowd. And they're in a remote area near Bethsaida, which is not all that big of a place, but a hub for that remote area. And it would be like you and I maybe saying, oh, the need is too great. I just can't do that, Jesus. Or that's too much for us. We just can't do that, Jesus. Or to look at our location and say, location, location, location. Do you know where we are, Jesus? Do you know what we're up against where we are here? To be fully fed, we allow God to work in our lives even when the proportions are disproportionate to what we are able to supply. In our lack, He is enormously abundant. He is enormously generous. He is enormously able to provide. In our lack, in the Gospel of John, about this same feeding of the 5,000, Philip first. There's a Philip and an Andrew story that we don't get in Luke. Philip says, we could go buy food in that human nature. We'll fix it on our own power, in our own authority, not relying on the authority of Jesus. They had had that big lesson. Remember that field trip that they went on, that field experience that they had in his authority? And they come back and now they've all of a sudden forgotten about his authority. And Philip is saying, we can go buy the food, but we don't have that kind of money. It would take at least 7 months of wages, at least 7 months of wages to have even just a little bit for everybody. Andrew, where do these 5 loaves and 2 fish come from? Andrew brings up a boy, and he is a boy. He is a child. He is a lad, a little lad. And these loaves he have, they're not the big bread loaves, that stick outside of the grocery bag. No, they're wafer-like. They're biscuit-like. And the two fishes, or the two fish, they're not the prize-winning trophy-sized fish. No, they're like little anchovies or sardines that would be on a biscuit, a cracker. And so again, they can look at their situation and they can say, too many people, we can't do that. Too much money, we can't do that. Too little resources in bread and fish, we can't do that. Too few experienced people, we can't do that. But if we're fully fed, we see the miraculous multiplication that Jesus and Jesus alone can do. We see the miraculous provision of the 5,000 and their wives and children. We see the miraculous provision of, and there's more, and there's more. And he blesses, and he blesses, and he pours out, and he pours out. That's what our God does. This quote is from Spurgeon. God is not baffled by our lack. He can use our paltry means to accomplish his glorious purpose. Therefore, let no man's heart fail. Oh, if you're fully fed, if you're fully fed, you're spiritually fed. And if you're spiritually fed, you won't have spiritual heart failure. Oh, I know the enormity of our needs. So great they seem before us. So great they seem before our human ability. In the critical care unit, the people who need more calories, more nutrition, if you will, are the sickest patients. You know, if you have a fever, your metabolic rate goes up. You need more calories. If you have an infection, your metabolic rate goes up. You need more calories. If you have a broken bone, an open wound, more calories. If you've been significantly burned, more calories. If you're shivering and chilling, more calories. When our needs are so enormous, and our human ability seems so limited, we need more calories. You know who else needs more calories in the critical care unit? And this is fact. If you're interested, I can show you. Our metabolic rate goes up when we are stressed. Our metabolic rate goes up when we have anxiety. Our metabolic rate goes up when we have worry. So the injured, the infected, the despairing, they need more food. They need more food in the ICU. And you know who needs more food from the Word of God? Anyone and everyone who's wounded, who's hurt, who's suffering, who's despairing, who's worrying, who has anxiety, who is strapped with fear. They need more. They need more of the Word of God. They need a double portion and another portion and some more. They need to stay in the Word until they're satisfied in the Word, until they're satisfied that Christ has got them. He's covering them. He's their hope. He's their source of life. He's the source of healing. He's the source of recovery. He can take this situation that is desperate and turn it around. People need more. They need more of the Word. They need more believers who believe the Word, who study the Word, who apply the Word, who practice the Word, who are in the Word, who have a biblical worldview. They need more believers who will carry the gospel, the truth of this loving, saving, life-changing, healing Word of God out to be fully fed. We look at these large, enormous, looming, desperate situations and we say, I know exactly. I know exactly what I need to feed on. To be fully fed is like manna. In Exodus 16 and Numbers 11, for sure, even in the Deuteronomy reading today, there's reference to God providing this manna, this bread that came from heaven in the wilderness to meet the physical feeding of the people. And they had enough, and they had more than enough, and they had left over. He fed them this bread from heaven, manna. I have a passage I want to share with you from John chapter 6, verses 32 through 35. Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Jesus is the true bread of life that comes down from heaven. Jesus came from heaven to earth and lived and proclaimed these messages and made those claims, and they are real and true and trustworthy claims. He is the true manna. He is the true bread of life. And as I said earlier, there's the physical feeding that is only temporary, and still men die. But when you've been fully fed with the bread of life, who's Jesus, is Christ himself, the true bread of life from heaven, you've been spiritually fed, and you can draw strength in that, and you can build muscle in that, and you can build boldness in that, and you can act in ways that are loving that you never thought you could do because you were underfed before. I'd like to share Revelation 2:17 with you. "Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches." This is to the church of I'm drawing a blank on how to pronounce my word. Pergam. Pereb. It's one of the seven churches. Christ is, through John, we have this message here. "Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches." This is one of the churches. And to this particular church, in each of the churches, Jesus found something to admire and commend, but in each of the churches, he found something to say, "But I find this fault with you." The fault that this church had is that they had become worldly. They had taken on this idea of anything goes kind of tolerance. Everybody's okay. Every belief works. Sexual immorality will allow for that. Worshiping other gods will allow for that. Now, they were also still true to God, but it was mixed in with all these other things. "To the one who is victorious, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give that person a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to the one who receives it." That white stone, as that invitation at the beginning today, that white stone is you're invited. That white stone is you're acquitted. That white stone is be in fellowship with me. That white stone that has a new name on it in Revelation 2:17, because you've been fed with the true manna, the manna that comes from heaven, who holds true to the word of God and the biblical worldview. That white stone, when you pick it up, when you receive it, when you take on Christ, you have a new name. That's what this is saying. You have a new identity. You belong to him. You're a child of God. You're a friend of God. You're a disciple, a follower. You're a saved one, a blessed one. Take up the white stone. Find your new name, your new identity, loved one. Loved one. Take up the white stone because you are taking on the spiritual food, the true bread of life. I'm reminded also that at the Last Supper, Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks to it, much in the same way he did when he fed the 5,000. He gave thanks, blessed, he broke the bread, he had it distributed. And at the Last Supper, Jesus said, "This is my body, this bread. This is my body broken for you. Take it and do it, eat it in remembrance of me." Another passage from Spurgeon, another verse from Spurgeon is, "God loves us for what we are becoming. Christ gave thanks for the trifles, both when he was feeding the 5,000, when he fed the 4,000. God loves us for what we are becoming. He gives thanks for the trifles because he saw whereunto they would grow. And Christ gives thanks for you and he gives thanks for me. He blesses us. He loves us. He sees who we're becoming in him, not with all of our faults, all of our shortcomings, all of our lacking, all of our enormous problems. He doesn't see us as that person, underfed, but he sees us as fully fed, fully fed." To be fully fed is to be fully fed by the Good Shepherd. Again, relating to this passage of feeding of the 5,000 in Matthew 6, 9 through 13, we have the Lord's Prayer. But in Mark, it says that, when Jesus saw this crowd of 5,000, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And we're taught the Lord's Prayer both in Matthew 6 and in Luke 11 to pray to our Lord to give us our daily bread. And the Good Shepherd feeds us. Others may have seen a mob, an inconvenience, an interruption. Jesus saw people who needed a shepherd. He saw these 5,000 who had followed them uninvited as sheep without a shepherd. And he had compassion on them. And we can be reminded then of Psalm 23. Psalm 23. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack nothing. To be fully fed, you will lack nothing, but to be fully fed, you're fed by the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ. He makes me lie down in green pastures." He had them sit down in the pastures, the grassy areas, there in the remote area outside of Bethsaida. "He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along paths of righteousness for his namesake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil." And if you have fear, you need to be fed more, fully fed, spiritually fed. "For you are with me, Good Shepherd. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." The rod and the staff both protected the flock and rescued the flock. "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." And he wants to set a table and fully feed you. "You anoint my head with oil," his hospitality. Fully fed by the Good Shepherd, who is hospitable to us and asks us to be hospitable to others. "My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days. The love of God shall follow me all the days of my life." ministry in the margin, in a remote, isolated place, in disproportionate need. Five biscuits, two sardines, a boy, but a Savior. A Savior who fully feeds, a Savior who invites you and me to accept that white stone invitation, to become fully fed spiritually, and as we are fully fed, then to be equipped to go meet physical and spiritual needs in the name of Jesus Christ and in the authority of Jesus Christ and in the power of Jesus Christ. Will you receive your new identity, your new name? Will you receive the full feeding of the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ, who will give you your daily bread? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us of our trespasses or our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us and have debts towards us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And we might add appropriately, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Receive your daily bread, church. Be fully fed by the Savior, the Good Shepherd. He loves you. He wants you. He's waiting for you at his table.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me. You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. So shadow you want to light up, mountain you want to climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up.
Conclude the service, I just want to take one moment to recognize the birthday of Sarah Gordon, the inimitable youth director of First Baptist Church, North Kansas City. So happy birthday,
happy
Sarah.
Birthday.
You're beloved to all of us. Have a great week, everyone.